I'm allowed to move my head, I suppose.
Yes, you are.
But okay. not to poke my nose.
If you would like that to be recorded for posterity, feel free.
Yes, right.
Okay. It is June 22nd, 1999, in London, in Golders Green. Melissa Hacker conducting an interview with Kurt Treitel in his home.
Great.
And when and where were you born?
I was born in Berlin. Do you want the address as well?
Yes, sure.
At Cuxhavener Straße 14. Cuxhavener, Cuxhevener, then Straße 14. In the Tiergarten district of Berlin, on the 10th of April, 1922.
And what were your parents' names?
My father's name was Theodor Treitel, obviously, and my mother's name was Hannah Lilly, and she, her maiden name was Levy.
And what kind of a neighborhood was it?
It was a very pleasant residential neighborhood, very close to, as the word Tiergarten may or may not evoke to you, very close to a large park in the center of Berlin, in which I played a lot. They had children's playgrounds there as well, and they also had some cafes in there. It was a very nice place. And also it was conveniently located for schools, which were on the other side of the river, because the house in which I was born was on a road that went down to the River Spree, and then across the river there was a bridge, and on the other side of the bridge was my original first school, for primary school, called Volksschule in Berlin, and later on, and next to that one, was the gymnasium to which I went until I was 15, and then I translated to the American school in Berlin. But then we come to that one presumably later in my history. Now, I was born there. It was a five-roomed apartment in which originally my grandparents had lived. They were called Marcus and Cecilia Treitel, and they had three sons, Theodor being the youngest. Then there was Hermann, and then there was Richard. All the boys, as we might say, lived with their parents until the parents died. The grandmother died in 1918, the grandfather died in 1921. Apparently, so my father told me, they were so happy at home they didn't see any need to get married. And so they, and also, of course, there was the war in between, the First World War, which was not an ideal time to get married unless you had a girlfriend before and wanted to marry her before you got killed off in the war. Fortunately, neither my father nor his uncles got killed in the war, in the First War, that is. And when my grandparents were both dead, first my uncle Hermann got married. He was married to a widow of a man called Levine. He was a rabbi in Berlin, and they had one son, so this boy came into the family, and my uncle Hermann never had any children of his own, and his wife called Frieda. Her maiden name was Gutmann. And Richard never got married. He first lived with us until my sister was born. With one child he could put up with, apparently the noise of two children was too much for him. He then moved to stayed with Hermann until 1939, when Hermann emigrated to Chile. Well, he was forced to emigrate because he'd been in a concentration camp, and one of the conditions of getting out was that he left the country speedily. And there he stayed, and then he was translated to what they call a Jew house, Jew flat. And in fact, at this reunion last week, I met someone who saw my label with the name Treitel. He said, "Are you related to Richard Treitel?" I said, "Yes." "Is he your father?" I said, "No, he was my uncle." And he said, "He stayed with my parents in their Jewish flat in Giesebrechtstraße in Charlottenburg in Berlin." So, I mean, the reunion had its uses. He actually found someone who they put all the Jews together into flats, who stayed in the same flat as his parents. And then my father married in 1921, and on the 17th of May 1921, and on the 10th of April following, the son and heir was born, that's me, you see. And my father was a lawyer in Berlin, and my mother, before her marriage, had been a kindergarten teacher, and so, which was a very useful thing, because being a kindergarten teacher, she, for obvious reasons, knew a lot of songs and stories, and was very helpful in educating us and bringing us up, because she knew how to deal with children. She stopped working when she got married, and in fact, one thing she did get from, inverted commas, her children, I mean, they were not her children, but the children that she looked after, there was embroidery in cross stitch. And later years, we looked at this, and my mother always said, I wonder how many of these were now going to be Nazis, because obviously this was a public kindergarten, you see. So we don't know. We never saw any of the children again. And now it comes your next question. You've asked me where I was born and when I was born. Next question, please. Unless you have anything that you want me to elaborate on what I've said already.
You mentioned a sister.
I have a sister. My sister was born in 1925. Her name was in Germany Zilli, now Celia, because in England the name Zilli is a bit silly. So when she came here, she changed it to Celia, and her second name is Ruth. She lives on the other side of London, northeast London, in Chingford. She came out with my parents at the end of July 1939, and my brother, who came with me on the transport, is the third member of the family. His name was Günther Heinz, and he now lives in Oxford, and 2 years ago he got a knighthood. He's now Sir Günther. He was a professor at Oxford for many years, and in law. And if you look up the top there, you can see some of his books. They're on the top shelf.
Ah.
The Law of Contract, G.H. title.
I see that. And when was he born?
He was born on the 26th of October, 1928, and my sister was born on the 21st of August, 1925, which, as probably your mathematical mind will teach you, that every 3 years my mother had a child. In the year 1931, I, as a little boy, was most disappointed. I fully expected every 3 years there would be another one. And I asked my mother, actually, and she said, well, things are not so good, there's a depression now, it's not the right time to have any more children, they never were anymore. Because obviously 3 years on, it was even worse. Nice. I mean, 1931 wasn't so good, 1934 would have been a lot worse. And so the family, and this is, I mean, one of the things in which I am reasonably fortunate, is that not only did I come out together with my brother on a kinder transport, which left Berlin on the 21st of March 1939, together with my brother, but my parents came out 3 or 4 months later. And my grandmother also came out, because my grandfather had died before in 1935. So he was dead, and the other two grandparents, of course, as I told you earlier, died before I was ever born, or before my parents were married, for that matter. So there we are. And in 1939, my grandmother would not come unless my grandfather was dug up in Berlin and the remains were put into a zinc coffin. He got to get a special permit by the Home Office, because she said she wouldn't leave without her husband, even though he had been dead since 1935. And so he is now reinterred here in the Jewish cemetery in Golders Green.
Was that difficult for him to get the permit?
It was not easy, and it was an expensive, I mean, for those days, a very expensive thing to do, because you had to have a special tin coffin to put them in. And then, I didn't get the permit, my uncle got it for him. And the uncle plays a very vital part in all this, because this uncle of mine, his name was Ernest, he was my mother's elder and only brother. And he had married a woman who was a British subject by birth, even though she was more German than English, But her father and mother, obviously, lived in Bradford at the time in the wool trade, and she was in fact born in the United Kingdom, in England, and therefore she was British by birth, and when she married my uncle, he got a right to come to England because he was married to a British subject, and he had a small business here, and he guaranteed me and his mother and my parents. He couldn't guarantee my brother and he couldn't guarantee my sister because his income wasn't large enough, but he found other people to guarantee them. So without my uncle and the effort he put in rescuing us, and had he not married this British subject, we wouldn't have got here. And we got here at the time we had applied for an American immigration visa under the then existing quota system. So we effectively all got visas for a temporary stay pending re-immigration from this country to the United States. I did in fact get an American visa, but that wasn't until 1940. And by that time, because of the U-boat war, the submarine war, there were no more ships. Well, there were ships, but I mean not ships in which non-essential passengers could be carried. So we I think sometime early in 41, the White Star Line offered my father two passages for himself and me, because they were prepared to risk males, but not children and females, you see. So my father said, I'm not going without my family, so that is why he was interviewing me here, rather than in America. I mean, had I got to America then, my whole life probably would have been different, but it didn't materialize, because, I mean, after we'd been here now from 1939 to 1945, in 1945, probably our original guarantor wouldn't have renewed the guarantee, because this man was not a relative of ours. He had been the partner of a firm who was, I think they called him president in America. The president of this firm was an original German immigrant in the 1890s to America, had become a millionaire, and he was one of my father's clients. And he gave us the guarantee then. But by 1945, obviously, our lives were no longer in danger. So why should he extend his support to us to come to America by that time? So we stayed here anyway. By that time, settled here. Not in this house, I mean, settled in England. And we didn't move into here until 1958. But that's a long time ago as well now, mm-hmm. even before you arrived in this earth.
So let me go back for a moment. How many generations do you know had your parents' families lived in Germany?
Well, we have, on our side and on the Treitel side, we can go back about as far as 1780. But though I don't have a birth certificate of 1780, I have a death certificate of about 1850, on which it says that this so-and-so Treitel was born, died this at this age. So he was in his 70s, so he must have been there about 70 years. And 1850 minus 70 brings you to 1780. And they'd always been in the same little town called Betche, Pschef as it now is. It's now Polish, but it was German until 1939. You know, when the last war ended, Poland moved west, and East Poland became Russian, and so they shoved the border towards the Oder-Neisse line, so that particular area then became German. But in the case of my other grandparents, I think it's about the same, that's the maternal side. They go back about the same time. So around, one would say, to about 1770, but I can't go beyond that because I haven't got any proof anymore, but we certainly have got birth or death certificates, and we also have somewhere, it may even be in that folder that I've got over there, if not it's somewhere else, a naturalization certificate as a Prussian citizen from 1834. And I mean, that was certainly helpful when I reapplied for German nationality after the war, because you had to prove under German nationality law that you had a connection with Germany through birth. So we can go back, as far as nationality is concerned, to 1834, and as far as birth certificates are concerned, to about 1780, which is quite a long way back.
Yes. And did your family, did you, your parents consider themselves Germans, Jewish?
That is a very nice question. Now, my father didn't consider himself German so much as Prussian. When we had what they call a census, I don't know whether in America you have a census. Every 10 years or so you have a census. So the last census, when my father was alive, he had got a form, a man come along, give you a form to fill in, and it said their nationality at birth, and my father put down Prussian. So the man came, he said, what's a mistake, it should be Russian. So my father, no, it's Prussian, because he was first and foremost a Prussian, then he was a German, but he was equally much a Jew. I mean, I can tell you a very relevant story to that point. In about 1930 it was, my father was also the legal advisor to the Social Democratic Party of Germany. And in 1930 the leader of the party said to my father, look, we need some more lawyers. And we want to put you fit. The German system is you go on party lists, and if you're fairly high up, then you're bound to be elected. Which is, and then you also have a second system. You can get either directly elected, but then you have to win the seat with a majority of more than 50%, or you go on the party list. And he would have been on the party list, but they said, but the man said to him, but his name was Künstler, there's only one condition. As you know, we're a socialist party, we don't believe in religion. You have to leave the Jewish religion and become an atheist. So my father said, well, I'm sorry, you'll have to look for someone else. I was born a Jew, I shall die a Jew. And on that condition, I will never accept. So in a way, it was a very good thing, because had my father been an MP and a Jew in 1933, his head would have rolled, as they said. So it was probably just as well. And I mean, my father was certainly a very knowledgeable and also, in many ways, I mean, a very practicing Jew. Throughout his life, he always said his daily prayers three times a day, morning, afternoon, and evening. But he didn't do it quite in the traditional Orthodox manner, in the sense that, for instance, when we were on holidays, he looked at his watch. I don't know how much your Jewish knowledge goes. He said, and for 20 minutes, he said his afternoon prayers while he was walking through a forest or something like that. He didn't stop, but he said them and he knew them off by heart, you see. And twice a year when he had the, do you know what the word Yahrzeit means?
Yes, but why don't you explain it for the...
Pardon? Where you say memorial prayers for your parents, you see. And on those days, I was always very proud of my father. He actually conducted the service from the bima in the middle of the synagogue, because he was capable of doing it. And he had this is rather, I think, typical of what German Jews were at the time. And that right up to the end of his days, he had on his bedside table a copy of the Bible, the Hebrew Bible, a copy of Greek books by Sophocles and things in the original Greek, and a book of Goethe. So, I mean, it was typical that they had this trinity, if I may put it that way, of connection. He loved his Jewishness, he loved his historic Greek and Latin. Sometimes he read Cicero instead of Greek, who was, of course, Latin. And he loved his German poetry. I mean, as a little boy, when I was three or four, he read to me, I don't know how much you know, you're Goethe, Heinrich Fuchs. And that's a very nice sort of fairy tale by Goethe that wrote that one in poetry and so on. So, I mean, I was brought up on stories from the Bible, on stories from Greek legends, and on stories from German literature, because that was my father and my father's background. My mother, as I told you, was a kindergarten teacher, so I learned the nursery rhymes and the fairy tales. So we had a fairly good combination of everything. But when to come back to your question, Yes, he was certainly a committed and proud Jew. At the same time, I can also tell you that right up to the end, right up to 1930, we had a large number of non-Jewish friends because of his connection with the Social Democratic Party. And also, he was much involved in his legal practice with artists, that is, both variety artists and film artists and operatic stars and so on. And, I mean, we had a Bechstein piano at home quite often. We had some people coming along playing music for us. So, I mean, my father's life, that is, was having his feet in all camps, as you might say. The one thing he didn't do anything with was sport. Sport didn't exist for him. But then in those days, I suppose sport was not something that a Jew would have done. Well, there were some, and there were wonderful boxers, of course. Do you know, I mean, as you're young, you might not know, but in the 1930s, we Jews in Germany, being persecuted by the Nazis, were extremely proud. In those days, there were 8 world championships in boxing, 6 of which were held by Jews. There was some of which you may have heard of, like Maxi Beer, Maxi Rosenblum. He held 2 titles by himself, and there were 5 others. That's 3 plus 5. But out of the titles, Jews were very good at boxing in those days. Well, the last great Jewish sportsman was Mark Spitz. He held 6 Olympic titles, I believe, but that was a bit later. Mm-hmm. All this has nothing to do with the Kinder transport, of course.
Well, the boxing didn't, but it's good information anyway.
If you want to know about the Kinder transport, well, you know.
No, I'm not up to that.
Yeah. Oh, you're not up to that yet.
No.
Okay. Next question.
So, did you...
Do I talk too fast for you?
No. Did you go to a synagogue as a child?
Yes. Well, there were 2 ways we did this. I mean, firstly, we went to synagogue anyway, regularly. But secondly, I went to a state school and not a Jewish school. I never went to a Jewish school. But we had a Jewish teacher who'd organized with the headmaster of our public state school that in Germany one went to school on Saturday morning, that every morning, every Saturday at 10:30, all the Jewish children were lined up in the playground, and then we marched under the leadership of our Jewish teacher with his wife at the back, and we all marched from our school to the synagogue, and from where we joined the service at 10:30, or just after 10:30, we left at 10:30, got there at 10:35, and then we stayed till the end, and then we marched back to school again for the last hour or so. And the Christian children were then allowed to play, I suppose, because about half the school was Jewish. So every Saturday morning we went to school, into synagogue anyway, apart from that, on Jewish holidays, we were always allowed to have time off because, as I just said, there were so many Jews in our class in the primary school that it was fully accepted. I mean, we had not only the high holidays, those we had off altogether. I mean, there were a few Jewish children whose parents had opted out of the Jewish religion and they didn't want their children to go to synagogue, but mostly, I mean, in my class in the primary school, we had, I think, something like 24 children, out of whom about 15 were Jewish. So if we didn't come, the rest of the class went on an outing. They went marching around the suburbs, somewhere in the forests or in Berlin. But on the foot festivals, I think they're called, Regalim, we all had time off, and we could go to the synagogue on Pesach, we could go on Shavuos and on Sukkot as well, so there was no question about it. And as I said earlier, we also had a smaller synagogue, which was more Orthodox, and to which my father had gone at a very early age. In fact, to some extent, I'm not saying it had much to do with it, but to some extent, his marriage was due to that synagogue, because when my father had met my mother at a party somewhere, which was an uncommon way of meeting a young lady, my grandfather phoned up someone He said, I hear that this Dr. Title is a member of the synagogue you go to. What do you want to tell me about this title? So this man said, well, who's got in between? That was my idea. I was going to introduce him. So my grandfather said, Zalu, if that's the way you feel about it, that's good enough for me. I'm not asking any more questions. So that was that. We also had across the road from us, I mean, we had very, my father rather, had very Catholic tastes, and I don't mean Catholic Roman, but very wide-ranging tastes. We also had across the road a Hasidic minyan, where we went on Shabbos afternoon. They had little feasts there and some lectures, and it was bedlam, but it was great fun. And every week, someone provided either some sardines or some schmaltz herrings, if you know what herrings are, and some beer and some lemonade and so on. So we had, this was, only Hasidim did this, the others didn't do that. But the synagogue that we normally went to, I'm not sure whether I've got it here, I think it is here. I got, they gave you a prayer book, which as far as I know I still have. And it's not one you can do as much in England because the translation is in the wrong language, if you know what I mean, it's in German, obviously. But we went to synagogue during school term regularly every Saturday from the, with the school. When I went to the secondary school, this ceased because in a class of 16, there were only four Jews. There weren't many Jews, and the teacher we had then was a nice man, but he didn't teach you anything. Rather, he did teach you archaeology. I mean, instead of teaching you Hebrew or Jewish history, when he taught, well, it was Jewish history of sorts. His name was Zilbermann. Dr. Zilbermann came along with books showing excavations that had been done in Egypt and been done in Mesopotamia, and trying to correlate the stories in the Bible with the stories of the excavations. And we learned a lot about Jewish archaeology, but not much Hebrew from him. He was a nice man, but as a teacher, I would rate him one or two possibly, but not much more than that. Whereas the other one probably rated 8 or 9. I mean, no teacher is ever perfect, but that one as a teacher was no good, but as a person was good. And in a way, I suppose, had I just been taught Hebrew, which I could learn anyway, I might not have remembered so much about Jewish background in the history, because having taught you archaeology, I suppose you then go on from there. Now, equally, when I had my bar mitzvah, it might give you some idea of the Jewishness in which we live, as well as something else, which I hope you'll laugh when I tell you. When I had my father had a large number of friends who were rabbis. Well, amongst his friends were a large number of rabbis, put it the correct way round. And rabbis being what they are, I'm not a rabbi, by the way, but they like to talk. I also like to talk. And each of these rabbis felt he ought to address the bar mitzvah boy. That was me, you see. So, we had a sort of catered kiddush there, where everybody was having lots of food. It was all there. They all sat down at 8, and I had to stand up there listening to Rabbi 1 to 7, one after the other. And by the time they'd all finished talking, all the food was gone. So I had imbibed 7 sermons, as it were, and not a morsel of food. So the funny thing is, I only remember one single phrase from all these speeches, and that was one of these rabbis had just written a book, and he gave me his newly published book, and he said, "There v'echtav ha'sefer v'echtav." I wrote the book and I signed it. These particular words actually came from the, do you know what a mufti is?
No.
That is the portion from the prophets which the bar mitzvah boy reads on his bar mitzvah. So in that, there was a portion from the book of Jeremiah, and it said in there that he signed the document and he sealed it. So he used those self-same words, it's signed, I wrote the book and I signed it, you see. So it was very appropriate and apposite to the occasion which had just happened, namely my bar mitzvah. But apart from that, I don't remember any of the rabbi who actually performed, if I may put it that way, at my bar mitzvah, later on emigrated to Melbourne, Australia, and he's now dead, but he would be because, I mean, as you've just heard, when I was born, he was born even earlier, obviously. I'm not saying he had to be dead, but he is dead anyway. But I've asked people who lived in Melbourne, Australia, and apparently he had made quite a reputation in Australia. He emigrated to Australia. He was then a young rabbi, but that's a good thing he went, because had he not gone, the chances of survival would have been somewhat reduced. And the rabbis that were there radiated from extreme right to extreme left, as it were, because that's another thing. When we had these assorted guests, sometimes we had non-Jewish people then, of course, different. But when you had, when my father said, next week we have a meeting of Rabbonim, so my mother went and bought all things from strictly kosher shops and left all the wrappings around it so that the rabbis could all safely say, because, you know, rabbis are very funny people. They don't eat something unless they can actually see it comes from the right shop, etc. So when we bought that, and other days we had a more mixed group, including a large number of non-Jews, and then it was different. But in my grandparents' house, for instance, I think the number of non-Jews who came there was very, very limited. My father had obviously a much broader field. Now, that the same applied to my uncle Richard. He was the one who never married. I mean, he's the eldest one, and he was, in my view, a very brilliant man. He was a Stadtrat, in England they would call him an alderman of the city of Berlin from 1920 to 1930. And when Hitler came, in 1930 he wasn't re-elected, which was good again, because had he been re-elected he would have also been killed. But he then decided he didn't need to practice anymore, he was going to concentrate on Jewish studies. He had a friend, Rabbina Link, and Rabbina Link taught him for 2 years. And then Rabbina Link said to my uncle, Dr. Teitel, I've taught you all I know. From now on, you're on your own, or you'll have to find a more knowledgeable teacher than me. And he found Dr. Weinberg. Now, you may never have heard of Rabbina Weinberg, but he was head of the Rabbina Seminar. He was head of the Orthodox rabbinic seminars school. There was also the other one, the head of the other, the Hochschule für die Wissenschaft des Judentums, was Rabbina Ismael Bogen, who, to the best of my knowledge, escaped to America in the end. And when I was in the Holocaust Museum in Washington, they have, you know, moving pictures there. And on one of them I saw the picture of Rabbina Elbogen teaching at the Rabbina Seminar. I mean, they obviously filmed him as head of the seminar. So we had the heads of both of these seminars amongst our friends. And also, on the other side of the picture, we had the widow of the first president of the German Republic, and the last president, a democratic president of the Reichstag, Paul Löbe, and the other one was Luise Ebert. And they were both at our last New Year's Eve party in 1938-39. So, I mean, that friendship endured. And I will tell you a short address that Paul Löbe gave to us on New Year's Eve 1939. And it was more or less, it went as follows. On my way here, I passed the church, and as I arrived, there was a bridal coach coming by, and the bride came out of the coach in a white dress. And as she was stepping into the pavement, a lorry went by, and it splashed all the mud on her dress, and it looked bespattered. But she looked up at her fiancé, well, to be her husband any moment, and her eyes were radiant. She was looking into a bright and happy future together with her husband. And he said, you, my dear friend Streitel, you too have been bespattered by the public in the street. But in your home, You are who you are. You know who you are. We know who you are. And you will be going. We know that you will escape from this hell in which we are living, and you will go towards a brighter and better future. And there will come a time when things will, when we'll be looking different again. That was a very nice thing to say, and I've never forgotten it. As you can see, it's now from 1938-39 to 1999. It's quite a time ago, but one remembers these things even 60 years later. And so, where were we? We were amongst the rabbis and my Jewish education. And I also belonged to one or two Jewish youth clubs, but I was not a great clubby. I didn't like going to clubs very much. My mother, the only club I liked going to, looking at me now, it sounds strange. I liked going to a tennis club. We had a Jewish tennis club. And I also liked going to a boxing club, which sounds even more strange to you now. But my mother said, well, if you're attacked in the street, you have to learn to defend yourself. Now, I don't know whether you have any brothers. No, you wouldn't know anybody who did any boxing in that case, because girls don't box. Not many. I mean, I'm not saying there aren't some boxing girls in America. I mean, one sees it on television sometimes. You get American girls who do box. But boxing is not what you think it is. You don't stand there and box for 2 hours. Boxing, I mean, going to a boxing club and learning to box is 99% physical training. Jumping and skipping and exercise at the bar. And 3 minutes only. At the end of each boxing lesson, you're actually in the ring. Now, I can only tell you something. When I was in the ring, I was always wondering what my career was going to be, whether I'd be an astronomer. I've never seen so many stars in my life. Every time somebody hits you on the chin, you see stars exploding all around you. So I didn't become a boxing champion, but our club actually was very good. And before the Nazis came into power, you know where the Nazis are, I take it?
Yeah.
No, because my wife said I must always explain who they are. They're the National Socialist Workers' Party. Anyway, so the club I belonged to were the boxing champion club of Germany for many years. We had some very good boxers there, but of course once Hitler came into power, they weren't allowed to fight non-Jews because it would have been inconceivable for a Jew to beat a German, you see. So they were only allowed to box amongst each other. Right, carry on, next question, okay. Please.
Do you remember when you first heard that Hitler had come to power?
Will I ever forget it? Indeed I did, yes. Sorry, but I have a bit of a cold. Better to blow my nose than to start standing and burst out. Yes, I do remember, because firstly one had heard about it. I mean, throughout the whole of this summer, from 1932, in Germany was a very unrealistic period. There were elections after elections. There was an election on the 6th of March, on the 13th of March, on the 10th of April, my birthday of all things. Then there were elections in the summer. There was prime minister after prime minister. The first ones were for president of the Reich, the way when Hindenburg was re-elected in two elections. And then there were various parliamentary elections. The last one where the Nazis won a lot of seats was in August. Then the Reichstag was dissolved again, and then in November they lost a lot of seats. And there was this fear, I think, amongst the right-wing industrialists and landowners that communism would take over in Germany, so they persuaded Hindenburg against, I think, his original will to appoint Hitler. And I mean, I have a book here which I find interesting. It's called Hitler Regiert, which was published in 1933 after Hitler was appointed. Many people seem to think that the government was National Socialist. It was, in the sense that Hitler was Prime Minister or Chancellor, same thing. But there were only three other members, apart from him, who were members of the National Socialist Party. All the others were not. They thought that they had a sort of nominal or notional head, that was Hitler, and that they would control him. Well, they didn't. He controlled them, and he eliminated all opposition in next to no time. By half a year later, they were all gone, or had emigrated. And what you then got was a regime of terror. I mean, I don't have to tell you that. That's too well documented. And on that afternoon, we always got our newspaper delivered, and there was a big headline: Hitler, Kanzler. So, and there was, and that same evening, where the demonstrations, the torchlight parade, to which we did not go for obvious reason, because it would not have been very safe. But I know my uncle Richard, who came usually to us in the afternoon because we had tea there together, and he said, "Remember that day, you won't forget it quickly. That 30th of January is a day that will live with you as long as you live." And he was right. One has never forgotten it, the world has never forgotten it. I mean, you weren't born, I was born, but the immediate reaction amongst Jews was one of disbelief. They said, "Ah, let him get there." Like all the other chancellors, I just said earlier that there had been, I think, four or five chancellors that year, one after the other. You see, and he won't last more than 3 or 4 months. Then once people see that what he's saying is all rubbish, they won't believe him, and then he'll be out again. And then the conservative industrialists will take over again. They will know what it's all about. Right. So it didn't work that way, but I mean, and if you read this book here, which I showed you earlier, The History of an Obsession about Judeophobia, it's quite clear that very many Jews in Germany, until many years later, still believe it won't be so bad. Now it's stabilized. He only used that to get to power once he's there. He knows how important we are to the German economy and to the German life. But of course, all this underestimated the overpowering hatred that he had for Jews. I mean, one thing which, if you haven't experienced it, and you clearly haven't, and you couldn't, which was rather terrifying in many ways, when you saw these lorry loads of brown-shirted SA men swinging with their big flags, photographs of, you probably have seen, but and shouting, "Deutschland erwache, Juda verrecke." Now, there is no translation for Juda verrecke. Deutschland erwache means Germany awake. That's translatable. Juda verrecke, you can't translate. And they were screaming around the streets. That's one thing. The other one, at the corner of Unter den Linden, where my father had his office, and Friedrichstraße, which is crossing, there were these SA men with little boxes shaking them. He says, "Für die Einbahnstraße nach Jerusalem," for the one-way street to Jerusalem. I mean, they're collecting money, and people, and they more or less converged on you, forcing you to donate money to the Nazi funds. Also, though I have never heard Hitler speak other than on the radio or on the screen, a friend of ours who was a not very Jewish-looking Jewish woman, she went once to the Sportpalast in Berlin, the Palace of Sports in Berlin, where he spoke quite often, and she said, "If I wouldn't have been Jewish, he was mesmerizing. People, he came under his spell. He had a tremendous power of speech, and people were overpowered by his quite irrational, demagogic speech." And now I can tell you something which I have personally experienced, which is not Hitler himself, but in 1935, I think it was, maybe in 36, I'm not sure, doesn't matter much. I went to the school called Friedrich-Werrische Gymnasium, where my father had been before, and my uncles as well. And because we were a small school, there weren't enough pupils. Every school in Berlin had to produce a team for the festival, which takes place actually just now, for the summer solstice. Well, because there weren't enough boys, I, as a Jew, was allowed to go with this team. I felt actually quite honored about this. And we went along to the stadium where this took place. And they had one technique that they always kept everybody waiting there. So we were all sitting around there waiting, and we were supposed to perform before the what they call Eissportführer, the organizer of German sports, Herr von Chammer in Osten. And so then we performed it. In the middle of the performance, this von Chammer in Osten put his hand up like this, said everybody should be quiet. He said, "You boys and girls, Jungen und Mädel von Groß Berlin, boys and girls of Great Berlin, I have a special announcement for you and a special surprise for you. Waldo von Schirach, who was the Reich's youth leader for the charge of the Hitler Youth, you see, has come to address you, and he comes directly from the Führer." Now, once the word Führer came, there was an immediate automatic Heil, 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 Heil. And when Schirach came in there, the heiling went on and on and on. And then Waldo von Schirach, later on, as far as I know, became governor of Vienna, I believe, and then after that he went to Holland, I think, but it doesn't matter where he went. On that occasion he was there, and the first words he says, "Boys and girls of Greater Berlin, Jungen und Mädel von Groß Berlin, ich komme zu euch direkt vom Führer." And the applause went on for 2, 3, 4 minutes, I don't know how long, but it went on and on and on, because there was a man who came directly from the holy man. And I mean, this was not organized. This was spontaneous enthusiasm by the young people, 15-year-old boys and girls in Berlin.
Did you applaud or hide?
And I was there, yes.
But did you applaud or hide?
No, I didn't. I didn't. No, I mean, I had to put my hand up, because otherwise he would have said, "Why not?" You know, I would have got beaten up. But I didn't applaud. And it would have made no difference whether amongst 30,000 boys and girls one screamed more or less. But it was an example of mass hysteria, which was part of the strength and power, I think, of the Nazi regime. I mean, there was terror, certainly. There was also misleading propaganda, and I'll give you two examples of that, one in a moment. But apart from all that, there was an enormous amount of enthusiasm, because Hitler had made Germany strong again. He had removed what the Germans called the injustice of Versailles. He had removed unemployment. He'd created a relative sense of pride in being German again. And what happened to the Jews was overlooked. If you weren't a Jew, you couldn't care less. People looked the other way. They knew. I mean, nobody can tell me that they didn't know. I mean, to come now, jumping many years forward to the Kindertransport, I went via Hamburg on an American ocean liner, the SS Manhattan. Nobody can tell me that when 220 or 240 children walked through the streets of Hamburg carrying their suitcases with little labels around their neck, that nobody saw them. They were very visible. Nobody hid us. Of course, we didn't have Jew stars yet, but I mean, it was pretty obvious what we were doing. Nobody spat on us either. But I mean, nobody expressed any sympathy for us. They just didn't want to know. Why should they want to know? It didn't concern them. And until such time as Hitler began to lose the war, I think they were very enthusiastic for him. When he beat Holland, he beat France, he beat Belgium, he occupied the northern Scandinavian countries, he subjugated Poland in 3 weeks. What more do you want, you see? Colonies, possibly. So, what next?
Do you remember after Hitler came to power, do you remember your parents talking about what they should do or trying to get out?
Well, let me say, first of all, there wasn't anybody who didn't talk about it. It was obvious. Point two, yes. I overheard, I was only one, I was 11 then. Both my grandfather and my father being asked by their respective wives, that's my grandmother and my mother, shouldn't we go to Palestine or go to France, because my father, grandfather had fairly good connection with France. And both the husbands with the men, turned round to their wives and says, "You have never earned any money. You don't know what it would mean to leave 30% of your capital behind. Here we're doing well." They did well. Don't forget, one of the side effects of Hitler reviving the German economy was, of course, that Jews were also reviving their business, weren't doing badly. They did quite well. And though my father lost his political practice, he lost most of his other practice with regard to the artists and so on, he never got a growing Jewish practice, and though he never earned as much after Hitler as before, he still earned more than he needed to live, let's put it that way. So, and then a few people who had emigrated and were visited by people from, don't forget, in 1933, 34, 35, 36, you could still leave Germany, 37 even, you could leave Germany and come back again. And they visited people who had emigrated, and I know one of our friends came back from Holland, where he'd visited his daughter who had emigrated with her husband because they were young people, they couldn't find a job. And he said, "You have no idea how terrible it is. They have to live in a small three-room apartment, and they can't give parties. I mean, life is really terrible out there. They're so much better off here." I mean, people did not realize, because there was an outer world and an inner world. In the outside world, you were denigrated, you were run down, you were told you're a nobody, you're a zaujud, a dirty Jew. But once you closed the door behind you, you were yourself. Now, certainly, in the early stages, people like my father or my grandfather, my uncles and so on, talked about emigration, but in a way for others, for younger people. Yes, everybody realized, young people, they had no future. But they didn't think it would apply to them. Even as late as 38, my father said, "Now, even if I can't work here anymore, I still have enough money to live on the interest." So that's how it was. It wasn't until the summer of 1938, when my Uncle Hermann was taken into a concentration camp and came out on the condition that he emigrated, which he then did. And I remember my aunt telephoning us in September 1938, in the middle of the Sudeten crisis. Hermann is fire to house. So we went over there. The shock I got, and I've never forgotten how he looked. I mean, firstly he was shaven, then he had a shirt. You know, normally he used to be quite a stout man. He'd lost pounds and pounds and pounds of weight. He looked terrible, and then he said to us, I mean, maybe he said more to my father later, but when we were all sitting around the table, he said, "After what I've seen, I can't tell you what it is, all's too terrible. There is no way in which you can continue to live in this country. Get out, get out, get out as quickly as possible, because what happens there, you wouldn't have survived. I'm lucky I've survived," and he was. So then one realized that there was, that was before Kristallnacht, you see. In the summer of 1938, he was arrested as what they called a habitual criminal. Now, you might wonder what he did. He'd once crossed the road, not at the traffic light, but where there was no traffic light, and that was an offense under German law, for which you got an on-the-spot fine of 5 marks. So he had a criminal record for a 5-mark fine. As such, he was arrested as a habitual criminal, some habitual criminal. But be that as it may, until then, one felt that even if things got so bad that you wouldn't be allowed to practice, that you couldn't do anything, you could still go on living. I mean, I was then sent earlier than that to the American school because it was recognized that there would be no future for me or my brother and sister. And we had this aforementioned American millionaire. He said to me, let the boy go to the American school in Berlin. There was one, you see, where you could get credits for university entrance examination. And once he's got that, he can come to America and I'll take him into my business. And then when the others are bigger, they can come as well. But let him finish his education in here, where you can pay for it, and then later on I'll take him over and I'll take him into the business, you see. But time overtook us. It didn't work out that way, of course. I did go to the American school, and in many ways it was the happiest time at school that I ever had, because we had a very good teacher, Gregor Zima, and he published a book, by the way, called Education for Death, which he was published in the war. But there, at this American school, we were a mixture of Americans, Canadians, and various other non-German nationalities, and the largest number of Jews who wanted to prepare for emigration. So that was that, but...
Now, did your sister and brother, did they transfer to Jewish schools? Or?
Well, they had, when my brother and sister came to the age, well, let's put it that way, my sister first, because when she came to the age when she should have transferred from primary school, she was at ordinary state school, my father went along to the local, what they call the Lyceum, and he saw the headmaster there, and then he said, I'd like to register my daughter, and he said, so he said, yes, fine, then, here's your title, but you're not Jewish, are you? So my father said, I'm afraid I am. He says, well, haven't you somewhere got an Aryan grandmother? So my father said, no, I'm afraid not, we're all Jewish for generations past, there is no Aryan there. So the headmaster said, in that case, I'm afraid, under the regulations we have, I can't accept your daughter. So she had to go to a Jewish school. When my brother first went to school, Jews were no longer allowed to go to state school, so he had to go to a Jewish school. And then in the last year or so, when it became apparent that we had to leave to English-speaking countries, they too went to the American school, but only towards the end. And no, I don't think my brother did, actually. I think just my sister. My brother stayed at the Jewish school to the end because he was too young to go to the other one. But that's... No, I mean, I never went to a Jewish school. I first went to a German school and then to the American school. And so when I came here, as this chap said to me, who sat across the table to me at the reunion last week, I envied you very much. You could speak English. Well, of course, the point is, that's fine. But when you come to England, it is actually no great advantage. Everybody else spoke English as well. Can you see what I mean? I mean, when you come on the ship, everybody else spoke no English. I spoke fluent English. But the moment I landed in Southampton, English was something that everybody could learn very quickly anyway. So there we are. I don't know, how quickly did your mother learn English?
She had an English tutor in Vienna a little bit, so she had some English, but...
And then the rest came, obviously, more easily.
Yes, but yeah. She had to do in school trades. She could draw, so she didn't understand English for science class, biology at all, but she would do the drawings for the other girls, and they would do her work in English.
Well, she would have probably picked it up soon enough.
Yeah, she did.
So, I mean, the point is, knowing English is fine, it makes it a little easier, but it... was something which doesn't get you very far in England. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you'd gone somewhere else, maybe gone to South America and speak fluent English, you could teach English. But I mean, I had a few pupils here, refugees, whom I taught English at a shilling an hour. Well, it was better than nothing, you see, it helps. Helps to buy some sweeties.
Do you know how your parents heard of the Kinder Transport?
Well,
do you know how your parents heard of the Kinder Transport program?
I don't know, but I assume that it was in the Jewish press at the time. I mean, don't forget, we had a Jewish press in Berlin, and presumably it was advertised in there that that the British government had agreed to take 10,000 children, and if you wanted to, you could register. And I think, as far as I remember, once we knew about it, or maybe my uncle found out in London, I'm not sure which way it went. Whether my mother wrote to my uncle, says that I understand there's this possibility of getting children on a transport, or whether it was the other way around, my uncle said, I understand that there's a transport. And be that as it may, I mean, we registered for the Kinder Transport.
How did you register?
With the Jewish organizations in Berlin.
Did you go, or did your mother go?
My mother did that, yes. Yes, she did that, and then you waited, and then they they were in touch with England till you had guarantors. I mean, there were children, of course, who didn't have guarantors, mainly those whose fathers were in concentration camps. Well, I'm glad to say my father was not. So I didn't qualify under that category, and I didn't. I mean, I would have been horrible if he had. But I don't know how we got to know of it, but I'm quite sure that, the German Jewish press at that time was full of information of where you could possibly hope to get into a country that might take you, provided you had certain qualifications or skills or whatever. And so the only country where you didn't need any qualification was Shanghai, as you know, probably. Shanghai, all you needed was $100, I think, and your fare, either by ship, by Lloyd Trestino, or through Russia on the Trans-Siberian Railway. And Shanghai was the last hope, as it were. In fact, I mean, when my uncle was released from Sachsenhausen concentration camp, he was released on the presentation by my aunt of a ticket to Shanghai. He didn't, in fact, go to Shanghai because I don't want to go to Shanghai. And so they then eventually found that the, I shouldn't say this too loudly, but he's probably dead so you can see him, that the Chilean consul in Berlin, or vice consul, was bribable. If you gave him 1,000 marks, he gave you a visa. And only because the Chilean government at the time had apparently made it known that it was willing to receive non-Aryan Catholics. So my uncle had to learn the Pater Noster, the Lord's Prayer, and a couple of other Catholic prayers. So when he went to the Chilean consulate, he rattled off his Catholic prayers, got his Chilean visa, and then when he had to go to Paris, and they had to pay another $200, by the way, which had to be smuggled out for him. And then when he arrived in Chile, the first thing he did was to join the Jewish community, even though he'd emigrated ostensibly as one of the non-Aryan Christians, you see. But the Chilean government, I mean, this was also, because there were a number of Jews, of course, who were members of the various Christian faith. Right. And so they had agreed to accept non-Aryan Christians. Now, my uncle was never actually baptized. He didn't provide a membership of any, or signature or letter from any church, but the consul in Berlin was satisfied that if you knew certain prayers, that you could recite these. And he asked, do you say this every day? So my uncle proudly said, yes, of course I do. Well, he couldn't, he had to say it every day, otherwise he wouldn't have remembered it.
Right.
And then once he got his visa, he didn't have to say them anymore. And he then lived and died in Chile, eventually.
And on the phone you had mentioned something about the silk trade, was that? That's something, oh, Cuba, that's another family.
That's another part of the family, yes.
Right. Okay. We'll
that's my mother's sister and brother-in-law, yes. Mm-hmm. No, that is my mother's sister, Meta, and her husband had been in the silk trade in Berlin, and they, as you know, around Como, around Lake Como, they have even today, they have a large center for silk there. It's a famous silk area. So when they went from there, because they had business connections there, and stayed on Lake Como in Cadenabia, and they stayed there quite happily for about 2 years, and then Mussolini adopted anti-Semitic laws, and they then had to leave there. And they left, fortunately, before the war started, because once the war started, as you probably know, the story about the ship that went to Cuba and nobody could get off it, the St. Louis. You know the story of the St. Louis?
Yes.
So they weren't there before the St. Louis. So in those days, if you bought your visa, which you could get, then you were allowed to land, and they lived there and waited. They'd registered on the American quota for immigration to the United States, and then and being relatively close to where they landed, they went to Georgia, Atlanta, Georgia, and and my uncle lived there until he died, and so did my aunt, but she died later, he died first. And they had three daughters, and one of the daughters now lives in New Jersey. One still lives in Atlanta, and the other one lives in Florida somewhere, but I don't know where. So that particular one who lives in Florida married a non-Jewish husband, and they have one boy as far as I know. The other one who lives in Atlanta married a man who was in the concentration camps and escaped and apparently made a very successful career in America, and he's quite a rich man, but that's by the by. I mean, I suppose if you're fit enough and strong enough to survive the concentration camps, you can stand up to anything. It's not exactly a good school for life, it's more a school for death, but if you do survive alive, I think you've proved that you can stand hardships and overcome them. So they went to America, yes.
Okay. Now, did your parents explain the Kinder transport to you? That
we didn't need any explanation. Even my little brother was only 10. We all knew, and I mean, he said at the time, there are only two things which can stop us. We were always hoping, waiting for this visa to come through. He's only two things that can stop us, the K or K, Krieg or Krankheit. You know what the words mean? Krieg is war, Krankheit is illness. And I had to get on that transport because I was 11 years, 11 months and a half. And yet we had to be under 17. I mean, my birthday, as I told you, was on the 10th of April, and I left Germany on the 21st, arrived England on the 24th of March. So there were only 14 days left before I would have been too old.
Wait, you said you were 11 years old.
No, I was 16 years, 11 months, and 14 days. And you had to be under 17, so I had to be on that transport. Otherwise, it would have been too late, and then it would have been much more difficult to get a visa, because for Kinder transportees, as far as I know, they had a group visa. You see, they arranged that they were guaranteed by Bloomsbury House, which was the refugee organisation in London, and we were all here on the basis of somebody guaranteeing us. I was guaranteed by my uncle. Right
now. What did your parents tell you about what they would do after you left?
Try again to get a visa. What else could they do?
Do you remember the day you left?
Yes. I mean, yes and no. It's funny. I do remember the morning. I mean, we, as you will see from the document that I can show you later, we had to be at the station at 7:30 in the morning, quite early, and even by German standards. So we got up quite early, and that morning was probably the only time that I can remember my father crying, because he didn't know then that he was going to get a visa. He didn't know when war would break out, because everybody knew it would. He didn't know whether he'd ever see us again. So I don't know whether you know the Jewish expression, benching one's children, blessed when he put his hands on our head, and gave us a fatherly blessing, and with his tears streaming down his face. And then he stayed at home because he couldn't face going to the station. My mother took us to the station, and I do remember my father and my mother standing there saying goodbye to us, and then she took us to the train, and we children of the transport were all assembled there, and a number of parents were there, and we were all pushed in with our one suitcase each. With our suitcase, we were sort of eager to get onto the train, and we found ourselves a seat on the train. We looked out of the window and waved. And after that, I remember nothing. I don't remember what happened on the train journey until we got to Hamburg. I remember getting out at Hamburg, but between embarking on the train and sitting there with the other children, and I was told by my mother, you must must hold your little brother, Sandy. He was only six, you see. He was 10. I was 10, and I was 16. No, he was 6 years younger. So he was 10, and I was, so I looked, he was in the same compartment. There were six other children, but eight children in each compartment. And the people I felt very sorry for were the people who led the transport. Each transport had eight adults, and they had to come back to Germany. Now, it must have been terrible to be able to get out of the cage, out of the power of the swastika, and then have to come back. Most of them had 2 days in London, and used, after they delivered us, you see, they were given 2 days, and most of them, I think, managed to arrange some sort of visa whilst they were here for these 2 days, but not all of them. Some of them went back and forth, and in the end were caught in Germany and, well, presumably annihilated, destroyed, murdered, whatever word you like to use. Doesn't matter very much. But, now, when we got to Hamburg, I know we all got off the train. We were lined up quite orderly, as in West German fashion, and stood there. Each one carried our suitcases. Some of the very little ones had their suitcases carried by the elderly ones, by the eight elders who were escorting us, because we had some small children as well who couldn't carry a suitcase very well. But most of us could, and or rucksacks, whichever. And then we marched through the streets of Hamburg, and that's what I told you earlier. Nobody could have overlooked us, a group of obviously Jewish children carrying little labels around their necks. Couldn't have been invisible. They must have been visible. And then we went down to the docks, and I'm very fond of ships. I always liked ships. I've loved them today. I mean, there was this beautiful American ship with the stars and stripes at the stern, and we embarked on the gangway, and I felt that once I was on the ship, the ship was still in German territory, admittedly, but I was out of reach of the Nazis. I was on the way to freedom. I was on American soil. And don't forget, having been to the American school, my dream was still to go to America. And in fact, on the same ship, admittedly, we traveled third class as transportees, but even that was quite comfortable. On the same ship was a boy who had been with me at school, and he traveled first class, of course, because if you... one thing you could do if you left Germany, you couldn't take any money with you, could still buy a first class ticket, you see. So I was once allowed to visit him, and I can assure you, the SS Manhattan in first class was a wonderful ship. And I've got this menu, which I bought in Chicago, of all things, on the last night of the ship, and I'll show you the menu, what wonderful food they had then. I don't remember all the food, but I do remember the first night we were on the ship, you see. You may or may not know, but kosher meat, that is, was no longer allowed in Germany. So the first night, we got kosher sausages, with sauerkraut and hashed brown potatoes, and we thought it was a wonderful meal to get kosher sausages, you see. So, and then we also saw a film on the ship on the second day with Shirley Temple called The Little Rebel. So that's what I remember about the crossing. But I do remember something else. As we were still sailing, we'd left Hamburg port, we were sailing down the Elbe River towards the North Sea. We're still within German territorial waters, and I was speaking to some English woman who was in on that trip, and I said how happy we were that at last we'd got out of Germany, we were free and so on. And she said to me, you'd better be quiet, you're still in German territory. There are spies on the ship who listen to everything you say. If you say anything, it might be bad for your parents. You'd better be very quiet until you get to England. So she was probably right. Because there were, obviously, people who were spying us. The other funny thing about the ship, I do remember this, I don't suppose you will find that nowadays, on whatever ocean liner you go to. When I opened the wardrobe, you found in this wardrobe the life belts, which everybody has to have. Now, that's by itself is not so surprising. But what surprised me is that the instructions how to use your life belt were in seven languages. one of which was Yiddish, because obviously these ships had been used for many years to carry immigrants to the United States, many of whom were Eastern European Jews who could read only one language, namely Yiddish. So there, I mean, in Germany this would have been inconceivable that you'd have a notice in Yiddish. It proved to me how welcoming the United States was, that even on a ship taking you there, the notices were written in a language which you could read and understand. And then we arrived, I don't know whether you want me to go there yet or not, we arrived in Southampton. Well, before, we being on a ship, you see, it took rather longer. Most people went on train transports through Holland, and you've probably heard at the reunion how this one lady said, how she still could, when she closed her eyes, she could still taste the orange juice and the white bread and butter that she got from the Dutch ladies. Do you remember that?
Yeah.
And now when we arrived in Southampton, there were what we call, so nicely, what I call committee ladies. These were reasonably affluent English Jewish ladies. And they stood there at the quayside very early in the morning, and each child got a little paper bag, which I don't have anymore. And the bag contained two sandwiches, one cheese and one tomato sandwich, and a bar of chocolate, and either an apple or an orange. That was the only difference between the, some people got oranges, some got apples, but we all got, this was our first, or in a carton of juice, a small carton of juice, so we had something to drink as well. So that was our first reception here, and I can't say that I remember the taste of it as this lady did who spoke at the Kinder Transport, but it was very nice. When we arrived there, as we came off the train, each one of us was given a little bag. Now, I'll jump ahead now, by the way. These committee ladies continued their good work for quite some time afterwards, in not far away from Bloomsbury House, in a place called Fitzroy Square. There was a sort of canteen for refugees, and if you went to Bloomsbury House, the refugee headquarters, you paid two English pence, which was about, what, 3 cents, I suppose, and you got a little voucher, and for that voucher you could go to Fitzroy Square, where again there were these committee ladies, and they gave you two big sandwiches, a bar of chocolate, and an apple or an orange or a banana for tuppence. Very cheap. And a cup of tea. So you didn't do badly at all. And the only funny thing is these committee ladies usually wore fur coats and looked quite affluent. And the refugee ladies on the other side with their tuppenny vouchers also wore fur coats, because though they couldn't take money out, they could take their fur coats out. So one must wonder whether these committee ladies weren't in some ways wondering, what are these women doing here, except they didn't put and wear jewelry, because Jewish women weren't allowed to take jewelry out of Germany, of course. But they were dressed the same way, except that the styling was, of course, Germanic. And of course, that's another funny thing about it. When we arrived here, we were all dressed in somewhat Germanic style. Well, that's not surprising. But, I mean, my mother, for instance, said to me at the time, you never know where you're going to go. You have to have a tropical suit, you have to have a dinner jacket. You don't know what you'll have to find. So I had all sorts of clothes which I didn't really need. I still have, I don't wear it anymore, for one good reason, that I have somewhat expanded in size over the years. I still have a leather jacket, a beautiful leather jacket. She said, my mother, that is, she said, you might need to ride on a motorbike, you need a leather jacket. So we bought a leather jacket. I never rode a motorbike, I still can't ride a motorbike, and I still have the leather jacket. And for many years I could wear it, but then I got too big. If you'll excuse me, I'd like to. So let me get back to our transportation. On the way there, I mean, the reason I mentioned that is because when I went to the reunion, the chap who sat opposite said, one thing I particularly remember is that we bigger ones, that's all those over 15, we're allowed, we stopped in Le Havre for one day, we're allowed, together with our 8 seniors, to walk around the town. And he remembered this particular, the younger ones weren't. On most transports, you weren't allowed to land in France, because we only had a passport with a J in it. You see? So France didn't normally allow people with J's in their passport. But because they knew we were going to re-embark, that we had a chance to walk around the town, and it was quite nice actually. It was like a little mini cruise. And so, and anyway, the next day when we arrived in England at on a fairly cool March morning, but in freedom, that was the important thing. The temperature may have been low, our spirits were high, because we didn't know what, I mean, well, I knew where I was going. I was going to my uncle. But most of us didn't know where they were going. They didn't know what hostels they would go to, what life in a hostel was like. After all, I mean, if you are a child living at a home with your parents, the word hostel means nothing, unless you were in an orphanage. I mean, there were a few children who came from orphanages. They, of course, had already lived a communal life. Otherwise, many of them had been told, oh, I'm going to go to a hostel. But the word meant nothing to them, you see. I mean, they didn't say it in English, they said it in German. And some of them, of course, were taken to foster parents, some Jewish, some non-Jewish. Again, they had no idea what to expect. They came from home backgrounds, some poor, some less poor, some rich. Because don't forget, however rich you were in Germany, it didn't mean that you were going to go to a rich home here. It wasn't on the footing that you would come to a family of equivalent status. If your father was a factory owner, you could end up with a taxi driver, if you were lucky. Or you could end up with a furniture maker. If your father was a road sweeper, and I mean, I didn't meet a Jewish road sweeper until I was interned, when we had one. In fact, I mean, that one man who was in the internment camp probably felt no change at all. He'd been a road sweeper in Vienna, and when he came to the internment camp, he took up his broom again and swept the internment camp. But I mean, for most people, the change that was about to engulf them was unpredictable and unknown. But in spite of all that, the one thing which we all knew, that there wouldn't be any more swastikas, there wouldn't be any more Nazis, there wouldn't be anybody who was going to drag you away and make you feel not just second class, but fourth, fifth, seventh class, whatever class of human being you were still allowed to be at all. Don't forget, the status of the Jew by 1939 had markedly deteriorated. In the early stages, one always felt all right. Things were bad outside, but you still had your home. Now, I will tell you one little funny story, funny in a way, and on the other hand, not so funny. You probably know that in October 1938, after the Polish government had decided that Polish Jews would no longer retain Polish nationality, they were deported from Germany into the no man's land between Poland and Germany, which then led to the assassination of von Rath in Paris, and in Berlin at least, Jewish men were deported, women and children were not. In other places like Leipzig, the children were also deported, and the women. But in Berlin, only the men were deported. And it was known to the German police that the Jew had gone, he'd been deported to the Polish border. Well, after the Kristallnacht, they still had various actions in Germany when Jews were arrested into concentration camps. And there was a sort of underground warning that there's going to be another action, get the men out of the house. So men included, and even in Berlin, boys of my age. So we arranged, my mother arranged for us, for me rather, to be taken to the house of a Polish Jew who'd already been deported, but whose wife and daughter were still there. Now, I was 15, the daughter was 15, and this is relevant, as you will soon hear. And they had a cleaning woman who was a non-Jewish woman. She came along in the morning, and I was sitting there having breakfast, because I'd spent the night there. Now, this Polish Jewish woman had to explain me away, as it were, and so she said, well, This is my daughter's boyfriend that he spent the night with her. Now that is something which a German working class woman could understand, that a boy wants to spend the night with a girl. His girlfriend, you see. That's my daughter's girlfriend. So he spent the night with her. In fact, I had not spent the night with her. But I mean, that was, you had to explain somehow why a Jewish boy should be there at 7 in the morning or 7:30 in the morning. So I had ostensibly cohabited the night because this was the Nazis wouldn't come there to look for Jewish boys because the men of that house had been officially, her husband and her son had been deported, but she and her daughter hadn't. So I was sitting, you had some, in retrospect, strange stories. But and then the next day they said, well, it's over now, the Nazis have taken so and so many, you can come back home again. So I didn't have to spend another night ostensibly with this girlfriend, which wasn't my girlfriend at all. I'd never seen her before, but that's by the by.
Were there other things as a boy? Do you remember you not being allowed to go to public swimming pools or to the movies?
Well, of course, lots of those things. I mean, this is, again, this was quite obvious. I mean, firstly, I mean, I told you I played tennis, I did boxing. See? I mean, we had, but the difference is in the early days of under Nazism, the policy of the Nazis was that the Jews could do what they like in their own environment, but not with us. So we had a Jewish tennis club. We had a Jewish swimming pool, by the way. We had a Jewish sports ground. A very nice Jewish sports ground where they're large. I ran there every week on Wednesday afternoon. We had a Jewish theatre, which you probably know about, the Jüdische Kulturbund, which was very good. I mean, my introduction to culture came through the Kulturbund. I went to concerts, I went to theatres, I went to operas. They had cabarets, I mean, they had everything. But it was for Jews only, as they said in German, geschlossene Vorstellung, closed performances. Non-Jews were allowed. The only non-Jews who were there were the people from the Gestapo. They were always there in case somebody said something that wasn't allowed. And there's a very good book, actually, about this Kulturbund, if you haven't seen it. It's quite expensive, that's why I haven't got it. But there is one. It's a good book. And, we had Jewish restaurants, cafes where ordinary cafes you couldn't go to because it says Juden unerwünscht, or if you went in, you took a risk. There were swimming pools where it said Jews are not allowed. And then for many years, I and many other Jewish boys went to the zoo because it had a large playground in the back. But then in 1938, Jews weren't allowed in the zoo anymore, which was a sad blow for me because I loved going to the zoo and we lived very near it. You couldn't go. I do remember on one occasion, and that was on the 12th of March 1938, when the Anschluss took place in Vienna, which you no doubt heard from your mother. I was, not because of the Anschluss, I was at the Postal Museum that day with a friend of mine. And then all of a sudden the loudspeakers went, everybody is supposed to go into the large auditorium where there will be a special address by the Führer. So we all went in there. Everybody had to go in because all the galleries were being vacated, you see. And then, of course, the first thing they did was sort of start shouting, Heil, 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 and all put their arms up. Now, Jews were not allowed to do that anymore. It was forbidden for a Jew to, we didn't have Jew stars, so it wasn't obvious that we're Jewish. But both my friends, his name was Herbert Frankel and myself, didn't put our arms up. So one of the ushers, I suppose you can call them that, I don't know what else you can use, the people who supervise it, came over and says, why don't you give the German greeting, Deutschen Gruß, why don't you? So he said, we're not allowed to be a Jews. So he said, you dirty Jew boys, get out of here. We don't want you. We don't want you here. This is a German museum. You're not allowed to be in here. It didn't actually say so then, but Yes, of course. I mean, equally, I mean, my German school in 1933 only, not afterward, we had one boy in my class whose father was a member of the SR, and shortly after Hitler came to power, he always waited. He was bigger than me, he was taller than me, and stronger than me, and he had great fun in beating me up every day after school. I didn't tell my parents, because no sense, they only would have worried about it, and they might have taken me away from the school. So he said, Juden werden alle umgelegt, you Jews will all be killed off. My father said so because he's in the SR. But after about 3 months, he had enough of this game, and he stopped it. And by and large, I mean, I was told this afterwards, when I met some of the former boys and our elderly men from my school, and they said, we always regarded you as one of us. We know you were Jewish because you went to Jewish religion classes. But we felt you weren't like other Jews. I don't know whatever that meant to be, but I mean, he said you were decent and you were honest and you were straightforward, and we treated you like one of us, except for this one. And I'm pleased to tell you, perhaps I shouldn't be, that this particular boy fell fighting for Führer and Vaterland outside Leningrad. So in the end, I'm alive, he's dead, you see, so we'll never know, you know. You never know. I mean, in fact, out of our class of 16, six boys died in the war, and out of those six, five were the most ardent little Nazis we had. So maybe they volunteered for the arduous task. But as far as I know, not one of them was actually in a concentration camp, because then he would have survived. The only one of these ardent Nazis who did survive, of all funny things, became a well-known psychiatrist in Germany. Now, I don't know what that says for psychiatrists. I hope I'm not offending anybody in your family. But he had a large clinic in West Germany and did very well. And his Nazi past was obviously forgotten. Perhaps he psychoanalyzed himself and saw the evil of his days. Now, I can tell you something else. One didn't always know who was good and who was bad. My father, in his earlier days, had a friend from his little hometown whence he came. And after the war, we got a letter from his wife that her husband had been taken into the concentration camp of Sachsenhausen by the communists, by the Russians, and that he, my father, should write her a letter saying that he knew Boleslav Lausch and that he had always been a decent man and he had never been a Nazi. And my father said, well, how do I know? Before the war, I knew him, but how do I know what he did during the war? I can't write such a letter. And last year, when we went to this little town where my father came from, we inquired about him because they came from the same little town. And we were told, it's a good thing your father never wrote that letter. He was one of the worst Nazis we had in the village. He denounced a lot of people to the SS, and he was responsible for many deaths of Poles. Not Jews, because they'd all gone anyway, but he denounced Poles, and he was responsible for a lot of killings. And in the end, I mean, he died in this concentration camp, well, presumably was killed by the Russians. But you never know, you see. I mean, some people who were decent people gradually turned and became virulent. I mean, we had a cleaning woman at home. She came twice a week. And in the beginning, 1933, she said, oh, but what Hitler says about the Jews is all rubbish. I've known your family for many years. You are decent people. You're not, they can only be about some Ost-Juden, you know this expression, Ost-Juden, I suppose. That doesn't apply to people like you. That was 1933. 1935 came along, and she said, well, you know, Hitler's done a lot of good for Germany, and there must be something about the Jews, otherwise why should he keep on talking about the menace of the Jews and that they are a misfortune? If there wouldn't be something wrong with the Jews, I don't, of course, mean you for a doctor title, but there must be something wrong about the Jews as a whole. They wouldn't, they've exploited our people for so long. I mean, they began to believe it all. And then came 1936, a year later, 1937, possibly early part of 37, I think. She said, my husband said, I can't come to you anymore because they've told him at work, and he was by now a member of the party. He says, you, as a wife of a member of the party, can't work for Jews because the Jews are the misfortune of the German people. Without the Jews, we wouldn't have lost the First War, and they've taken all, they've stolen all our money, and they made us all very poor, and I can't come anymore to you. So the propaganda, I mean, it has been very, very strong. One of the very few books that I brought with me was a book by a man called Le Bon. Well, you may not have heard of him, Le Bon. Le Bon wrote a book called The Psychology of the Masses. It was written a long time ago, and we always felt, Goebbels must have read it. He said, Le Bon says in that book, Gustave Le Bon is a Frenchman. I read it in translation in German, of course. Not in French, my French is not that good. He said that if you tell a lie, make it big. If the lie is big and you repeat it, then people will say, well, it can't all be true, but there must be some truth in it. Tell the lie a little longer and they will believe it. Make the lie even bigger then, and they'll believe the first one that you originally said wasn't so bad. And in the end, the Jew was no longer regarded as human. He was subhuman because they'd been told that he was subhuman. And don't forget, when people were put into these cattle wagons, if one put you into a cattle wagon with 100 other people, with no facility for washing, no facility for using a toilet, and 5 days later you come out, you will stink. You will look filthy, you will look dirty, and you've been told for years, Jews are not like us, they're different. They're a dirty, subhuman species. They'll believe it, and then they kill someone they don't regard as humans. So, I mean, there was this difference. And there was, of course, the question of fear. I have got a photocopy only of a death sentence imposed on a German Christian woman, not Jewish at all, who in 1944, I think it was, had sat having cake and coffee in a German cafe, and she said to her friend, der Führer ist ein Verbrecher. And she said, apparently just a little bit too loud, when two men came over, turned over their lapels, showed that they were, said, we're from the Gestapo, and they arrested her on the spot. She was taken before the People's Court, which is not court at all, and within 24 hours she was hanged for having, I mean, this was done quite deliberately by the Nazis so that they could make it known that any opposition would not be tolerated. There was a regime of fear. And the fear, coupled with the propaganda, made people believe that the Jew did not deserve to live. And again, in the area in Berlin where I live, they've got a little memorial there in the street where there was once a synagogue. The synagogue is gone, but that synagogue was a collection place for Jews for that part of Berlin to the railway station for deportation. And it tells you on this metal memorial, 15th of June 1942, 256 Jews, Auschwitz, 17th of July, 143 Jews, Treblinka, etc. So it goes right down how many Jews were sent on each of these days. And whenever they were collected at the synagogue, there was a synagogue which I became bar mitzvah, and it still stood, but of course now it's gone. These Jews, having been kept there for sometimes 48 hours without food or drink, then walked through the streets of Berlin with their little suitcase, and by that time they had a Jew star, and there was no question that they weren't holidaymakers going on a holiday. These were Jews being deported. And the people in Berlin, this was in the northwest of Berlin, which had been, before Hitler, a very left-wing area full of communists, Firstly, there were no protests. Secondly, they couldn't have overlooked them. They must have seen these Jews being sent to the Beuselstrasse station for deportation, and everybody knew it. Now, I did mention this uncle of mine, Richard. Now, he was deported from Grunewald. Now, we had a very good friend. His name was Horlitz, and he was not Jewish. He was a good Aryan. Now, this Horlitz, I'll tell you a little more about Horlitz because he deserves to be told about. He's a very good man. Now, Horlitz shared his rations with my uncle, and he accompanied him. I mean, he was walking along the side of the Jews being taken to Grunewald railway station as far as he could, and then, of course, when they were on the train, he could just wave goodbye, and that was it. He couldn't join him anymore. Now, I'll just jump forward a little bit, and then I'll jump back again. Now, I went to Berlin the first time in 1962. Now, that was the 70th birthday, and it so happened it was the 70th birthday of this Horlitz, and I went into his house in the Grunewald where he lived, and he stood there surrounded by nothing but non-Jews, because there weren't any Jews left. And as I came into the room, he said, "Na kurz, was macht die Mischbuche in London?" Now, he knew enough there. Now, to jump back to 1938 and to Kristallnacht, on the 10th of November, the day after the burning, we got a telephone call at home from a Czech friend of ours. He lived below. He said, "Come runter to me, come into my flat. The Gestapo is next door." If they didn't come to Czechs, you see, even though he was Jewish, they didn't, because Czechs were still foreigners and foreigners were not arrested. So we came there, and he said, "You can't stay in your home because they're next door. They're collecting all the Jews in this street." So my father and I then took the train from Tiergarten railway station where we lived out to Grunewald, and we went up to where this Horlitz lived. And when we opened his wife opened the door, and he says, "Ah, come rein. I know why you're here." They knew, of course, everybody knew in Berlin what was happening. "Let's have coffee and cake, and then we'll discuss what we will do." So we had coffee and cake and calmed down a bit. It's the only time, by the way, in my life that I was really in absolute fear. I was shaking with fear because everybody knew what was happening. It was terrible. I mean, I was told, couldn't look at myself in the mirror, that I looked white. I probably did. But anyway, we sat there, and then this Horlitz and his wife said, "Well, what we'll do is this." They had a maid who didn't live in. At 6 o'clock, we normally send the maid out to get the latest evening paper from the station. Now, before she goes, we'll say goodbye to you. Then you, instead of going to the station, which you normally do, you turn left. When you see the maid going out of the house, you quickly come back, and then we'll take you upstairs in the attic. "Yes, come in." As I said, then you, when you see her going around the corner, you go the other way, and then we'll take you upstairs. And when the maid is gone in the evening, we'll bring you down. She went at 8:30 usually, after she'd washed up for dinner. Then you can come down into the dining room. We'll give you something to eat. But during the daytime, you'll have to stay in the room. We'll give you a potty, you know, a bucket. But you mustn't come down. You can't use the toilet upstairs. She mustn't know that you're here, because she was a Nazi, you see. Now, so all day long we had to be there. We had a radio out there, but we couldn't come down except very early in the morning, before 7, when she gave us breakfast and washed it up herself, so that the maid shouldn't say, "Well, there are 2 extra cups," you see. And in the evening, after she'd gone, and at night we could also use the toilet or even the bath. But they hid us up there, even though that had the maid found out that we were there, then he, this Horlitz, would have ended up in a concentration camp as well for helping Jews, for hiding Jews. That was a very great risk to himself. After a few days, then just before we left Germany, as you know, Jews were not allowed to take more than, I think, 1 piece of table silver or something. We left all our silver. My father gave our silver and also his watch and my uncle's watch, to hold it. He said, "Wir können es doch nicht mitnehmen, das schenke, I give you that as a present." So far, so good. That was 1939. 1946, I got a letter from the authorities of the docks of London that two suitcases had arrived in the docks. Could I please address them? Could I please identify them and open them in presence of the customs officials? Well, my father sent me out there. I went out there to the docks. I opened the suitcase. So two suitcases. And there was our family silver. And my father said, wrote to this hall, it's in Berlin. He says, "Thank you very much, but I'd given you this in 1939. I never expected you to give it back to me." And we got a letter back from him. "I never regarded this as a present. I was only acting as a trustee for you during these terrible times of Nazi oppression. Now it is yours, as it always should have been, and I hope you'll enjoy eating with it again." And we've got our silver here. I can show it to you, some of it, because some of it went to my sister, some went to my brother, but I got one third of it anyway. And also, I mean, this Horlitz had, as I said, he had two gold watches, very expensive gold watches, by the way. And when the Russians came to Berlin, you may or may not know, but the Russians were very keen on watches. Do you know that?
No.
Well, the Russians always wanted watches, which they called Uhrlein. And if they had and saw any watches, they stole them. Now, this Horlitz tied these watches round his leg, his calf, with a big bandage, and limped around. And had the Russians found them, he would have been shot dead. So even after the war, after the Nazism had gone, he still took risks on our behalf, and both these watches were then actually given to my sister, who was with the American Army in Germany at the time, and she brought the watches back. But I mean, he did everything. Also, he was accused after the war because he had been a property manager. He took over a large number of Jewish properties and was accused of having enriched himself on behalf of the of Jews, against the interests of the Jews, not on behalf, against Jews by having taken these Jewish properties. Now that self-same Horlitz, long before there was any restitution, restored all these properties to the original owners, and he said, I only took these because otherwise they would have fallen in the hand of the Nazis. I was a trustee for you, and they all got their properties back. And as a result, and once that came out, I mean, he was accused actually by communists of having been a Nazi collaborator. But once it became clear what he'd actually done, he was made an honorary citizen in the air of his town and became a burgomaster of it because he had acted in a clearly honorable capacity. So now I'll have to ask you to stop again.
Okay.